And now, it's time to sit back and enjoy the Two True Freaks Internet Radio Broadcast.
Disney won't stop. Hope Mullinex and Chris Honeywell have finished Clone Wars twice and Rebels once. Now they move on to Resistance and beyond. I'm Gene, the MC Machine, and this is J-Guys and Jedi.
Hi everyone, welcome to a brand new episode of J-Guys and Jedi, a weekly podcast talking about something Star Wars. I am Hope Mullinex, I am your host, and normally Chris would be with me today, but we'll get to that in a second. I would like to say that I am joined this week by my great friend, and I'm so excited to be here with me. She is the co-host of Behind the Blast Doors Live and the Geeky Waffle Networks, as well as a writer and reviewer of Star Wars books over on her website, arzud2.com. Welcome to the show, my friend, Arzu Amen. How are you doing, love?
I am good, Hope. How are you?
Tired.
Well, Hope just ran the fabulous Rebels Remembered, for those of you who have been living under a geode-shaped rock.
Yeah, and I don't want to sound like I'm complaining, because it was really a lot of fun. I just, I was not estimating how much it would take, it took out of me, so now I know, and I'm, like, ready for next year, and I'm just gonna, like, go ahead and, like, know it now, and it's gonna be great. So, yes. So you guys, you might be wondering why Chris isn't here. We got to talking, me and him, and we were discussing how there is just so many things in Star Wars that I would love to cover on the show, but, like, you guys know that he's not a big book fan. He's not really into the books. He's fine with the comics, but he doesn't read them and stuff like that. And then there's topics like Thrawn, who I love. And I thought it'd be fun just to do a series with other guests so we can, like, cover these topics. And so if anybody can see my and Arzu's DMs at any time, you can just see us just being like, oh my God, the High Republic. And I just wanted to talk with somebody about the High Republic because I'm just so excited about it. And I really enjoy what they're doing. So I don't want to call this a mini-series with J-Guys and Jedi, but, you know, every once in a while we're going to be doing this together with me and, like, other guests to talk about the show. And I just couldn't think of anybody better to have on this episode with me than you.
I'm so excited to talk High Republic. Like, so excited.
Well, first and foremost, I do have a question for you.
Yes.
If somebody has never watched Behind the Blast Doors Live, or has listened to the Geeky Waffle, or has been to rzd2.com, what are they? What are they missing?
Okay, so Beyond Blast Doors Live is a live weekly, like, news-style show that just covers Star Wars. So some of it is speculation, some of it is, like, current events, sometimes we have special guests, and that's essentially what it is. It's me and my two co-hosts. We'll have, like, three topics, we'll just deep dive for an hour on Wednesday nights, just live on YouTube. And then
it's a lot of fun, you guys, really.
Yeah. It's always a fun discussion. Like, last week we had, you know, our live chat was really engaged. So that was a lot of fun. It really, like, feeds the energy.
Mm-hmm.
And then over at the Geeky Waffle, we've got a few things going on. So we have the main flagship show, which is sometimes it's reviews. Sometimes we're doing, I guess, podcast essay style stuff. So we just recorded an episode on Enemies to Lovers as a trope. What it is and what it isn't, which I led because I am deeply passionate about Enemies to Lovers. Yeah. And then we have our spinoff series, Straight Out Home Video, which Hope has actually appeared on, and it's a fabulous episode. Please give it a listen. She was talking with Candace and Brie about The Lion King 2.
Candace found out that people think that animals are hot.
we had this whole thing with Candace prior to one of our other shows, where she did not understand the Kovu thing, and every other person in the show was like, I don't understand why you don't get this. So,
I know.
So you're not alone, Hope.
It's okay. I think I've kind of accepted I'm like a secret furry, because everybody I want to fuck in Star Wars is like Zeb. So it's fine. I'm secretly a furry. Whatever.
Fine. It's fine. And then, yeah. And then we do live streams with the Waffle as well. So things like, we just covered WandaVision, and we're going to cover all the upcoming Marvel and Star Wars shows. So Falcon and Winter Soldier, Bad Batch, and then Loki. And we did, like, a Mando Night thing prior to this. So that's what's going on over at the Waffle. And I write on their blog as well. And segueing into writing, there is my own site, rzud2.com, and it started as a general blog, and then I'm like, I kind of need a focus, and we're also going into quarantine, so this was about a year ago, and then I was like, well, why don't I just review all of the books on my bookshelf, starting somewhere, and we'll just get through my whole shelf by the time we're out of quarantine. I'm like, let me just start with Star Wars. It's March now. I'll be done by June. I'm not done yet. And it's one or two books a week, and I'm still not done. So that should give you an idea of the volume. But it's exciting now because now that the main run of adult YA and middle grade books are done, now it's kind of the new books as they come out. And I've got a once a month special, I guess, series ongoing with a friend of mine who is a early modern drama lecturer, and the two of us are going through all of the William Shakespeare's Star Wars books together. So it's nice because I've got the canon side of things, and she's got like the theater background. So we're putting that together, and I'm particularly proud of that series. So yeah, that's so cool.
That's so cool. Yeah, I actually I really enjoy your. I'm still working through like your blogs over on rzd2.com. But what I really appreciate is that you really pointed out a lot of things about High Republic that I kind of missed. It never hit me about like the colonization aspect of the Republic until I read it on your side. I was like, yes, it is. That is exactly what this is. Yeah. And I really enjoy your perspective a lot because you definitely catch a lot of things that I don't. So.
Well, it's likewise. Like when I talk animation with you, I'm like, okay, that happened. And you're like, but did you see this? And I'm like, I did not. And then you'll dive a lot deeper in. So it's just the perspectives, right?
I just really am happy to see your face.
Yeah.
I'm just happy to be talking to you. Talking with girls, so great. I'm so used to having a male co-host. I'm just like, you mean I have someone to get thirsty on the show with me? And it's not just Chris going, oh, geez.
And thirsty we will get because, oh, boy.
Yeah.
Oh,
so what are your first impressions? Just kind of, I guess I should date this episode. So far, I guess this is like the end of like phase one, right?
Phase one actually is apparently going to extend into next year. This is just round one of phase one.
Round one. Okay. So at the time of this recording, Light of the Jedi, Into the Dark, A Test of Courage has come out. And then we're 3 issues into the High Republic comic and 2 into the High Republic Adventures, right?
Yeah.
And then I know there's 2 short stories that came out in the Star Wars Insider. I haven't read those.
Neither have I.
Okay, cool. That's
I'm honest. Also waiting for the comic trade paperback because my plan had just been to get them digitally on the Marvel app or wherever IDW makes things available digitally. And I'm just so excited about this new era. I'm like, no, I kind of want a nice bound print version of this. So I pre-ordered both of those and I'm waiting for them.
I'm probably going to be trading in my my floppies, floppies being single issues, my floppies in for a trade paperback because I used to run a comic book store, so I just can't. I don't like digital comics, so I found a nice little store in Atlanta that I've been hanging out with, and they're so great, and I love them to death. So what are your first impressions of the High Republic so far?
So I love that it's just so fully removed from the Skywalkers and their drama. I love me a Skywalker, you know that, but I feel like it was starting to get to the point where we're churning in the same pot for too long, adding too much seasoning to the same dish, and it's just like it's starting to taste weird. So I like that we're moving away from, like, give it a little room to breathe, let it all settle a bit, and then we can visit that era again. And I do sort of like being so thoroughly removed that, like, it's a Star Wars period piece. You know what I mean? Which I find fascinating.
Yes, I do know what you mean, because I've read your Marjan Rowe corset-ripping piece. Fanfiction, yes.
Just a little corset-ripping.
That was so good. I was like, yes, those titties are out now. Get it. No, but I totally get what you said, because it does feel like it is a different era. It's 250 years, which on one hand it doesn't feel like it's that far removed, but it's enough removed that you can really see the downfall between, like, where the High Republic is and the prequel trilogy Jedi, which are so similar, but they're also so vastly different. And I'm just waiting to, like, that's what I'm the most excited about, is watching how they film. Because there's some... Oh, I guess I should go ahead and say, because I'm a great co-host and sound professional about all this, we're talking spoilers in this show. There will be spoilers for the books and everything. So many other people have done spoiler-free stuff. So I would highly suggest our buds over at Friends of the Force. They've done spoiler-free reviews. Go check out Brian Sarah, because they are doing a really great job with their High Republic coverage. excuse me. Allergies. But I'm really... That's where I want to know. I want to know, like... It's kind of like watching season 7 of Clone Wars. We know the end story for Rex and Ahsoka, but it's a telling of the journey of how to get there. So going into this, we know the end story for these Jedi, but it's the how do we get there that's really fascinating to me, because we have stuff like the Starlight Beacon. Where is it? We know it's not in the prequel era. Where is that going to be? And seeing how, like, monkish the prequel Jedi are versus the High Republic, where they're just like, it's kind of like guidelines, you know? Yeah. Like, what is that transition? And that's what I find, like, really fascinating.
And I feel like with that, because they go from sort of these almost like celebrities in the galaxy, these benevolent, well-known celebrities, to like this monkish order that by the time, you know, Han Solo rolls around, he's like 10 years old during Order 66, and he doesn't really know who they are. Mm-hmm. So if we're getting to the point where this widespread order of thousands is somehow going completely unnoticed in certain pockets of the galaxy, whereas right now they're all over the place and they're all anybody talks about, how did we get there? And it's like, like you said, we see where the Jedi end up as a concept. We don't know where any of these characters are going to go, because they're not going to live that long. So, you know, that is still wide open. Yeah.
And, you know, when you were talking about celebrities, one of the very first things that stood out to me about these Jedi was in what book am I having? Light of the Jedi. I told you I'm tired today. In Light of the Jedi, on page 31, when the Jedi ships first come out, of you know, to come help and stuff like that, they're described to be surfaces ripple. The ship's surface rippled along its frame like waves on a silver sea, tapering to a point with towers and crenellations along its length like a fortress laid on its side. All the wings and spires and spirals. And this is the part that stole out to me. So it's like, okay, it's a pretty ship. And it said, it spoke of ambition. It spoke of optimism. It spoke of a thing made beautiful because it could be. That because it could be, those four little words, with little cost and with little consideration given to cost or effort, that screams hubris to me.
I get it if you've got this sort of not all powerful, but if you've got this really prominent order that is sort of known for its benevolence, and they've got the favor of the Republic, which I'm going to get into later, for like,
good, rip them, girl.
Like, I'm just gonna rip this to pieces. Yeah. But like, for how like flashy they are, if they feel Republic adjacent, why wouldn't they be flashy a little bit? And I've got to say, this is like the plot twist of the century, because I am such a like slut for Jedi stories, and then like the Jedi show up and I'm like, you know what, don't talk to me. Because of the way they're portrayed in this, I'm like the individual Jedi, sure, but I'm already mad at the Jedi Order, and I love the Jedi, so I don't know what's happening. That's the power of the High Republic. But yeah, so I'm agreeing with you, hubris.
Yeah, and that's a really good point, because I think there's a lot to be talked about between the difference between the individuals versus the group. But especially when you look at it against the prequel Jedi, because the Jedi Order feels like it's still very much the Jedi Order of the prequel trilogy, but it's the difference between hard rules and guidelines. And I think you can really tell that in individuals, because I've lost track of how many times reading these three books, I just go, man, Anakin Skywalker would have thrived in this time.
Mm-hmm.
Because he, if he didn't, you know, if he wanted to be with Padme, he could go off and be like a Wayseeker Jedi, you know? Yeah. He could have been like, I'm a master now, so I'm going to explore the Force through marriage. There's so, like, he would have just done so well. And I really enjoy the individuals. Who are your favorite Jedi so far? Because I have some favorites of my own.
Well, okay, so I'm deeply invested in Eivor and Elzar because of their
shipping?
Potential romance. because
shipping? Yes.
Because of the shipping, because that's what I do. The one that really, like, I generally am a fan of the individual Jedi that we have met. It's the order I have a bit of an issue with. But Dez Ryden from Into the Dark just broke my heart and stole my heart. And I just really hope that that's not the last we see of him, because you, like, Hope, you know me, I'm a big time Ben Solo fan. So there's something I find fascinating in a story of somebody who has either potential for light or a strong connection to the light that has it corrupted by an outside agent.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what happens to Dez. And he doesn't have the mechanism to deal with this. And it so thoroughly traumatizes him that he feels the need to go into isolation for an indeterminate amount of time. And this is why I'm worried we'll never see him again, but I kind of hope we do.
Yeah.
Because I
went back and I was looking back at the Charles Soule run of Vader, where we get the Bearish Val again. And it just seems like it's like, no, I'm just going to go on a forever Force vacation. And I was like, But I always thought, I maybe it changed. I gotta go back and reread that. But the Bearish Vow I thought was more like, if something happens to the Order, you have someone to restart the Jedi.
Yeah, but, like a secret reserve somewhere.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what it becomes.
Maybe, because I don't know, that dude was ripped. I need to reread Soul's Renovator. That was real good.
I mean, what else is he doing while he's there alone? Just a lot of pull-ups.
He looks good. It does. He reminds me of this is gonna sound so wrong, but let me explain, because it's gonna sound really wrong. It's like Thor and Odin had a love child. Because he has the face of Odin, but he has the body of Thor.
I mean, as wrong as that idea of the two of them having a child is, I see exactly what you mean.
Thanks. We're here all week, guys. No, I definitely like, especially with Eivor, how she sees the Force is really interesting. And I like that about the individual Jedis, is that they each see the Force differently.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a really cool way to explore how the Force talks to different people.
Yeah. I do like that it's not as uniform as I guess the prequels made it seem. Then again, the prequels, like, I know that there's thousands of Jedi running around, and we do have a lot of Jedi supported characters that we get a lot more of in the Clone Wars. But as far as the movies go, it's basically Qui-Gon, Obi-Wan, Anakin.
Mm-hmm.
Really. And then, so it's basically Qui-Gon dies at the end of Phantom Menace, and then we have these two emotionally traumatized Jedi men. I always make this comparison where it's like Qui-Gon was raising his son Obi-Wan, and then he finds out he has this other son he didn't know about that he then takes in to raise, and then he dies, and now Obi-Wan's got to raise this little brother he doesn't know very well. That's the family dynamic it feels like. And they're like, reluctantly.
I just thought of Lilo and Stitch.
But that's what it feels like.
Nani and Lilo. Like, my parents are gone. I guess I raise you now.
They're Nani and Lilo, though. And then, but that's they're true. Nani and Lilo without a support system. And with a support system, or whatever support system they have, telling them that whatever they're feeling is wrong.
Yeah.
So like you said, like, Anakin would have thrived in the High Republic era because the Jedi have a bit more leeway to be messy. And I feel like by the end of the Republic, they don't have that.
Yeah. I just finished A Test of Courage. And for one, that book surprised me. I thought it would be the one that I liked the least. But I actually really enjoyed it. And I think it's because I'm a character over plot person. If there's good character work can carry a bad plot. Mm-hmm. And I was just struck how it was about four young people and how these four young people handled grief differently. And it was a character study of grief. And I really enjoyed that about the book, especially seeing how Emery was handling the loss of his master. And then I started thinking about, and I wrote a piece over, over at geekygirlexperience.com. Just throw that out there.
Plug your piece, because it's a good piece.
Thank you. I started thinking about the Padawans, and we have so many Padawans, and I think that, this is Hope's tinfoil hat theory. I think we're going to be seeing the decline, not only of the Jedi, but their numbers as well. Because Kanan said that there was 10,000 Jedi at the height of during the prequel times, but they keep talking about how there's multiple temples, and I can't remember if it was Reeth or Emery, but they said there's something like hundreds of Padawans, and I'm like, that's a lot. Just having mm-hmm. hundreds of Padawans, you need the masters to take care of them.
And not every master has a Padawan, so they're masters without Padawans.
Yeah, so I'm wondering if we're going to not only see the decline of just them in the Order, the decline of their numbers as well, because we get to the point where Yoda can't even feel the light side of the Force, and he talks about that with Mace Windu. He's like, I can't even feel the light side. I'm having difficulty with this. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if, like, the cosmic force is going to start siphoning them off because the light side is so much throwing off the balance, and it needs the dark side as well. I'm really worried about these Padawans. I was tired, guys. It's fine. I'm really interested in the Padawans. We get so many. We have like Reeth and Emery, and Belle. Like I love Belle so much. And Reeth. Reeth is just a precious baby boy And I think it's interesting because we have the potential to grow up with these characters, and that will give us a really good idea of, I guess, the functionality of the Jedi Order, because we really have only seen the prequel Jedi from Anakin's point of view. We saw him as a Padawan, and Ahsoka's, I should say Ahsoka's as well. We see them as Padawans growing up in this order, how it changed them, and what happened to them. But we've never seen either of them really go on to become, like, masters. Mm-hmm. And I would love to see how each of them grow, but also see one fall to the dark side.
Of course. And,
yeah.
I think the interesting thing, too, because the two Padawans, essentially, that we see go through this system are Anakin and Ahsoka, but they go through the system in a weird way. Because Anakin shows up late, and then he shows up, and we don't see him again until he's 19 years old and weeks away from a battlefield promotion to knight. Like, he's basically at the end of his Padawan training, but the next time we see him. And then it's just 3 years left before his fall. And then with Ahsoka, we see her graduating from youngling to Padawan, but she does so quite literally on the battlefield. And that's the context we see her in.
She's a child soldier.
We know her in. Yeah. That is the only context in which we know Ahsoka. But the cool thing about this is that we are getting to know the Padawans in a temple setting. So like Reeth, right before he heads off to the frontier to meet up with his master, like the Padawans are throwing a party and somebody brought the moonshine that they brewed in the bathroom. Like, it's like a dorm party. And this is not something that we ever see in Star Wars.
I knew Reed was my boy because I too don't like parties, and he was just like, oh, I just want to go to like be in my room and read books. And I was like, me too, man, me too. I am not a party person.
Why do I have to go on an adventure? Why can't I just go to the library?
I can read my adventures, use my imagination. yes, that is my life. But yeah, there's a whole sex thing. Let's get dirty.
Let's talk about sex.
About sex, baby. Chris, can that be the song of the episode? Thanks. going to confuse everybody until we get here. Yes, Chris, make that the song of the episode. Let's talk about sex. Yeah, isn't that wild that, you know, all this is coming out that Jedi can have sex the whole time?
Well, like, Reef seems to think they can't, and then the older ones are like, no, it's fine. Like, you can. And then Avar and Elzar with their tragic, like, we can't because of the Jedi Order, and this is just, we'll always have Paris or whatever. Like,
that's amazing. Yes, that's pretty
much it. You're gonna devastate me. Tell me that's not what's happening here.
That's exactly what's happening. That's why it's so funny. But that, yeah, I mean, it's, I think it goes back to the guidelines. Though I did see, oh gosh, was it Mark Marquis from Clashing Sabers? It might have been Mark Marquis. I'm sorry if I'm misquoting you, dear listener, and you're listening to this. But somebody had talked about how, like, because I think they, didn't Mike Lucasfilm, like, release an article? Like, yes, Jedi could always have sex and blah, blah, blah.
I think it was one of the authors. Oh, yeah. It was something that I think Kevin Scott had said. And he's like, I'm just going to leave this here. And it was like, yeah, they can have sex. It's the emotional attachment. And all I'm saying is Kevin's writing the next book for adults. I don't want to say adult book because it's not, like, a romance novel. But he's writing, yes, he's writing Rising Storm, the next book for adults. And, like, I think we're long overdue for a Star Wars romance novel because they canonically exist too.
What was that? I think it was Mark Marquis said, oh, so this is the reason why nobody questioned Anakin not being in his room at night. They just all thought he was a slut.
But honestly, though, like, everybody knows.
Absolutely. I just love it. But I think that is interesting. I hope we do get to see that. And I don't mean that, like, let's get, like, a dirty sex scene, because that's what fan fiction is for. But you're right. I think we are really overdue for a Star Wars romance. And, yes, Star Wars is not, like, the most romantic setting. You know, it's wars and stuff, but it can be there. We have, like, of course, the greats of Han and Leia. And, wow, I just ran Rebels Remembers Day. Who is the couple of Rebels?
Kanan and Hera. And Kanan.
Thank you. Way out my brain.
Although I will say, I think Star Wars is long overdue for a romance that ends well. Because other than the Dozas, I can't think of a single one that... And the only reason the Dozas end well is because we don't know what happens to the Dozas.
Well, we do know that they make it out of Resistance, so that's a start.
That's like past that, like past, you know...
Yeah. I mean, everyone dies eventually.
I mean, I don't mean like, I mean, the only acceptable way for a couple to be separated is one of them dies before the other one, but they're both super old.
I will give you that, because every time a couple gets introduced in Star Wars, I've gotten to the point I'm just like, oh, what's going to happen to one of them?
Yeah.
I that's why I was so surprised by like, Pax and Rahara out of, like, Master and Apprentice. I was like, they're together in the end, and they're alive?
Oh, maybe no, it's better that we never see Pax and Rahara again, and we can just tell ourselves that it's fine.
I love them so much, though. I love them. They're so dysfunctional and precious.
An offhand mention in some book set, like, 50 years later about this really old couple, and their names are Pax and Rahara. We'll be like, good.
We're gonna get, like, from a certain point of view, Return of the Jedi. I'm gonna get Ghost Obi-Wan and be like, yes, I was hanging out with my friends, Pax and Rahara, I met when I was 17 years old, and they're fine. Anyway, let's talk about Luke. I'd be like, that's all I need. That's all I need. I just need to know they're okay. But no, I agree. I was the last, like, real romance book, Lost Stars.
Yes, that's the only Star Wars book that would classify as a romance.
I would slightly argue A New Dawn, because that's Kanan and Hera's meet cute.
That's true.
But
I think that some of the graphic imagery of A New Dawn scarred me. Like, the acid, so I'm just like...
shoving a woman in acid, and then...
Yeah, I just, past that point, I'm like, oh, God. But that's true. That is their meet cute.
I love Vidian. He's one of my favorite villains. I'm so sad he didn't make it out of that book, because I love him so much. He would have just been horrifying if he got, like, into... the Empire, like, for real. Like, yeah. He would have been just, I call him Business Vader, because he really is just the brutality of Darth Vader, but as a businessman. So, you know, Jeff Bezos.
Well, it's true. I feel like that's the one thing, is they introduce all these cool concepts and then they can't bring them past a certain point, because then it becomes, where were you in the movie? Which is, I think, one thing that Lost Stars does really well, if it wants to bridge that gap, is it's like, oh, wherever the camera was in Empire Strikes Back, if the camera was just a little bit to the right, you'd be able to see Sienna, but it's not, so you can't, but she's there. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, and then that's the thing too, but then not like Count Vidian, like Sienna and, oh my God, what's his name?
Thane.
Sienna and Thane are like so low on the ladder that like you wouldn't miss them anyway. But Count Vidian is just like, if you're not seeing him, there's a problem. You know what I mean? Like he should
yeah. see him
if you're going to go that far forward.
Yeah, but I always argue that one of the problems, one of my pet peeves of Star Wars is, for some reason, in a galaxy with tens of thousands of planets, with trajillions of people, we somehow run into the same 20 people over and over again. Oh,
that is very, very true. I don't know who I was talking to about this earlier this week, where I was like, small galaxy syndrome. It's the same 10 people over and over and over again.
That's my one thing that takes me out of Rogue One, which is my favorite Star Wars movie, is when we run into the two cantina guys on Jedha.
And the thing is, I'm like, how did you get to Tatooine so fast?
They had to be on a ship in like 7 minutes to get
like,
out of
there. They were, that's why God. They were annoyed that Jin bumped into them, because they're like, we are going to miss our flight.
We have to go to Cantina Land and go drink and get my arm cut off. It's just a thing.
Not Dr. Evazan, the other guy, whose name just flew out of my head. But he's like, why are you starting fights? We should have been there an hour ago. I told you we were going to be late. And he's like,
they're secretly gay lovers. And he's like, honey, this is why I told you to like update your alarm. No, it's not my job to wake you up every day.
That's, honestly, though, that's probably what's happening. That's why they're in such a bad mood on the cantina, because they had a fight the whole way over.
You just had to get those peanuts out of the stupid refrigerator in our hotel room. Well, they were delicious. They cost us 15 credits for a bag of peanuts, honey. I would have bought you one at the bodega.
Oh, my God.
Welcome to JS and Jedi.
I love it thank so you, much.
All right, so first, I'm going to, Chris, cut this out, because, by God, it's allergy season, and I have to be gross a second. Ugh. Yeah, I am an allergy sufferer, and we got pollen counts. All right, so just kind of, I'm sure we'll come back to the Jedi at some point, but I do want to talk about the Republic, because outside of the Jedi, so we have the Chancellor, Lena So, and I know you have some very strong feelings about
them. I don't trust Lena So at all.
You know, I didn't think about it until you mentioned that. And then I started thinking back on it. And I was like, yeah, you can see the politician in there. And, you know, after you mentioned that, who she really reminded me of, but this is going to be a kind of a deep cut thing that doesn't show up in the TV show. She reminded me of Ryder Azadi, but from the Thrawn novel. So Thrawn's novel, Ryder was the governor of Lothal, yeah, with the dumb white hat voiced by Clancy Brown.
And he's, I just love his name, because he fights for freedom on Lothal, and Azadi literally means freedom in Persian. I'm like, okay, well, that's a little on the nose. But like, my head shot up when they're like, Governor Azadi. I'm like, hang on. You want help fighting for freedom from a guy whose name means freedom? Okay. And then like, so that caught my attention. But anyway, sorry, that was my tangent.
Oh, I hope this doesn't ruin it for you, because what really reminded me of Ryder with Lena was his means to an end is unsavory, but he has good intentions. And in the Thrawn novel, he blackmails Orinda's mother to try and get her mine from her, because her mine has whatever the rare metal is that goes to the Death Star.
I totally forgot that was Azadi.
And he threw her in jail. And that is what put Arinda Price on her path to villainy. And of course, Arinda makes her own choices. Like, she could have stopped at any point. So that's not a thing. But he's trying to keep this metal out of the Empire's hands by blackmailing a woman and throwing her in prison. And it just, it's all political. It's just a political move. Mm-hmm. And it made me go, but man, he really is a politician. He's a, he's a freedom fighter, but he was a politician at the time. And that's kind of what I feel about Lena So. I really do think she has good intentions, but I think her means to an end is not good. And that's the simple version, because I know you're about to say a lot of beautiful words. So I'm just going to like get my seltzer water and sit back and let you go into Lena So and the Republic. So
the thing I feel about any, and I don't want to stick the villain label on Lena So just yet. I think it's a little early in the High Republic. But
this is speculation, everybody.
Yeah, total speculation. But the thing about any villain or morally ambiguous character is none of them ever think they're wrong. And that's what's important. But the thing with Lena So is she is so fixated on her idea of her great works. And what set off the alarm bell for me is not that others are referring to this as the great work of Lena So. Lena's calling it the great works of Lena So, which, you know, whatever, plug your work, be proud of what you've accomplished. But if it's like with writers, like they're like, set out to write the story you want to tell. Don't set out to write the great American novel. Like, if that's your goal, you're never going to get there. And her thing is like, what next great thing can I do? And I'm like, first of all, you haven't done it yet, so you don't know if it's great. Second of all, you think the Starlight Beacon is this great work, but you have not stopped to consider whether or not the people whose lives and resources are being affected by your Starlight Beacon beyond the colonists that you've sent out there, whether their lives are improved by what you've done. You don't seem to care. And this sort of a little bit goes into one of the High Republic comics, which does tie a bit back into the Jedi, but I feel like it's sort of on behalf of the Republic, which, full disclosure, I have not read the whole comic. I have seen this exchange. There's a world that's, I think it's Skeer and Avar are going to visit a world that the Jedi have not been to in over a decade. And they're like, it's time we visited them again. And the leader of the clan of people that live on that world are like, we do not want you here. And they can't seem to comprehend why this autonomous individual nation does not want them in their territory, because they feel it's their right to be there.
Well, we kind of got that a little bit also with Honesty and his family in A Test of Courage a little bit, because he was unsure about why the Jedi were coming to his planet anyway. I mean, of course, Honesty was just, him and Reeth would be really good friends, because they're like, let's just stay home and read, everybody.
I hope they get to meet, because Imri and Reeth are friends, and now Honesty is his friend too. So I feel like I hope they'll get to meet down the line.
They're gonna just make like a nerd team, team nerd. I'm currently doing a role play with my friend Megan, and of course, because we're messy timeline lovers, Anakin has crossed paths in a temple with Loden and Komak and Reeth and Belle, and Anakin's just like, don't fuck up history. But he's also like, Reeth is such a nerd.
Is Anakin like, I need to steal his lunch money?
No. He is with his lovely Sith girlfriend, and this is after they've overthrown the Sith, and they're just now teaching force balance in general. But all the Jedi Masters are like, he feels very dark sidey, and Jessica's like, let's stab the Jedi, because I'm an ex-Sith. And he's like, we don't need to stab anyone, guys.
Keep it friendly.
Don't fuck up history. Luckily, his girlfriend is a historian, too, so she's like, I know not to fuck up history, but there's Jedi in this room, and I hate everything they stand
for. So tempting.
I have so many biases. anyway, what were we talking about? Nerds. Okay.
Nerds.
Yeah.
Our they sweet nerdy boys.
But I think the colonization is a very interesting take, because I feel like Star Wars has been, for years, edging like towards that. Like, you know, Padme talked about that some in the Clone Wars of like, you know, we can't invade people's lands.
We get that a bit in Mando with the Tuskens think that the settlers are the invaders on Tatooine.
Yeah.
Which I'm automatically inclined to believe.
Yeah. But I don't think we've fully had, like, a multi-story, like, event about the effects of colonization. I guess we could say, like, the Empire is kind of, like, the reverse of that, you know, because the system was already in place. They just made it worse. But part of the reason why the Empire was so successful is they just took the system of the Republic and then just locked it down. And we see, like, them going on worlds like Thane and Sianna's world and just trashing it when it was once this beautiful place. But they colonized it. And it was seen as this really great thing because they were like, we're bringing jobs and resources. And the people
they recruit all your kids into the military and then they trash the planet.
Yeah, pretty much. And so I'm really excited to see if they go there, a multi-book story about that. I think that's a really interesting premise that has been skirted around far too long with Star Wars, but never delved into.
Well, multi-generational too, because like we were saying, like we're not constrained to movies or to an actor's age or anything like that. So with a 250-year timeline to play with and three phases of publication that are like a year and a half each, that is plenty of time for these characters to grow up. So like Reeth and Imri and Honesty and Avon and, oh God, what's her name? Vernestra and all of them who are all teenagers now could very well be the 30-something, 40-something masters by the time we get to phase three. So we see like the generational effects of Lena So and of her great works and of what the Republic is doing and how that affects the downfall of the Jedi and the mistrust in the Republic.
Yeah, give me one second. I'm having a computer thingy. My computer's just like, brr. Oh, because I forgot to close tabs before I started recording. That's why. There we go. Didn't close my tabs. Yes. I think the interesting end point in all this is, as we're going into this whole High Republic thing, is the Acolyte. We know that's at the end of the High Republic, and it's going to be a dark side show.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's going to be, what if the characters in that is somebody we know?
But who would live that long?
When is the end of the High Republic?
This is supposed to be 250 years before the Phantom Menace, where we're at right now. And the Acolyte's about 50 years before, so this is like two centuries away.
Oh, is it? Did they confirm it's the date of, is 50%?
The 50 years I'm not 100% sure on, but we are, as far as I know, 250 years prior to the events of the Phantom Menace.
Well, with going into this 100% knowing I'm probably wrong about this, just take it with a grain of salt. looking at how they have the new timeline now, the Republic of the prequel era is now called the Fall of the Jedi. And I'm wondering when that crossover happens between High Republic and the Fall of the Jedi, to go from High Republic to just Republic.
Right.
And where... Yeah, I mean, I think that's...
Maybe there's a cataclysmic event at the end of Phase 1.
Like the Starlight Beacon.
Like the Starlight Beacon. Yeah.
Crashing Titanic style.
No!
With Avon and Elzar just being like, I'll never let go, Elzar! I'll never let go!
That's not what I wanted.
But she's going to be so in love with him that she falls to the dark side and he brings her back. Just like Sianna and Thane in Lost Stars crashing.
They both survived.
But they don't survive, and Elzar brings her back, and he just doesn't want to live in a galaxy anymore where he can't openly love her, and she finally comes back to the light the last moment. He's just all like, I love you, and she's like, I love you too, and then they crash.
If I have somebody come back to light at the last second for one kiss and then they die, Hope, I'm going to lose it. I'm going to lose it.
But they're book characters, so you don't have to watch it be terrible. You don't have to watch it happen.
I don't have to watch a cute little dimpled smile right before he dies.
Oh, no. I didn't even think about that.
No, so I'm never not thinking about this. But I was thinking, like, the transition, like you were saying, from High Republic to just Republic, what if that happens? Yeah, like with the Starlight being, like, with the great failure of Lena So, and then this golden age is just no longer so golden because things go wrong. And they'll kind of upswing a little bit because the Republic doesn't fall right away, but it isn't what it was. So it's not the High Republic any longer.
And it's very clear when we get to the prequel era that the Outer Rim is still the Outer Rim. It's still not the fully brought in. They never fully got there. You know, the Hutts have a space. And I'm happy to see the Hutts in the High Republic. I think that's really cool. But we know that they never fully get there. And that there are parts of the Outer Rim that's still just like, I don't want to say it's fully the Wild West, but
I was going to say it's the Wild West.
Yeah.
They don't want it to be. But.
And then you get very much into, like, the wild space aspect, and then you have people like the precious boy Eli Vanto that's like, y'all, in my neck of the woods, y'all. Y'all.
Sweet little Wild West Eli Vanto.
I have this great, and I feel this is such a faux pas of mine because I always try to make sure I find artists and make sure I keep art with artists. And I can't find the original artist, but I have this picture of Eli Vanto with his hands on a wall with his head on a poster, and it's a poster of Dolly Parton. He's just like, Dolly, today was a bad day.
Oh no! But if there is a Galaxy Far, Far Away equivalent to Dolly Parton, you know Eli Vanto's a fan, and you know he's got a poster.
Absolutely. So I know that we're speculating that the Republic are not as golden, as light-filled as we think. But let's get into the real villains here.
Let's.
All right, so girl, tell me all the ways you love Marcio and Ro.
Oh my God. Okay.
I love his arms.
His arms, though.
His arms, though.
I don't buy single issue comics, but I really want issue 3.
I know. He's such a Dorito boy in the High Republic Adventures because he has that, like, that Chris Evans Captain America shape where he's very broad across the top and then it goes down to a tiny waist and he's a little Dorito boy.
He's got a swimmer's body.
Oh, he does. Well, he has to get nice arms somehow and then he, like...
Just the Gaze Electric has a pool in the basement.
I just love that it's called the Gaze Electric, because my God, does it sound like G-A-Y-S, the Gaze Electric. Every time I see that, I hear it. That's what I think, and then I'm like, no, no, wait, there's a Z in there. It's not the Gaze.
Not that kind of
Gaze.
Party boat.
It could be that kind of party boat. He could like multiple people. It doesn't have to be just ladies. I'm sure he'd...
Oh, no, I definitely doesn't. I mean, it's just because he lives in there alone, or virtually alone.
You know. How does he... His fingernails are so long. He has to be so careful jacking off. He says those, like, long fingernails. Somebody on Twitter did his fingernails.
That's what it is.
Well, then, in that case, just get a fleshlight, dude. Like, Star Wars fleshlights.
Oh, my goodness. I knew it was going to take a turn like that. I didn't think it was going to happen that fast.
Oh, remind me to tell you about the scene I have written about Thrawn and his wife having marital troubles, and she's sitting in a sex store crying over a blue dildo. Because she misses him so much. Because he's away doing Grand Admiral stuff. And she's just like, I miss my husband. Anyway, let's talk for real about Marcion Rowe and the Nihil.
Beyond the ridiculous thirst we have for a man we've barely seen, who better not have a goofy face.
Please, God, don't let him have a stupid face. Please don't let him have a stupid face.
Like, chiseled jaw or nothing. I'm just putting that out there.
I just would love to see just... that bullshitness of, like, they pull off the mask and he's like a snaggletooth.
I will fight. Like, this is not okay.
Well, it depends. Sometimes snaggletooth can be great depending on the anime character it's stuck on.
Okay, but, like, I don't trust them to make that cute. It's gonna be real, like, real hot or just a mess. I don't trust them to be somewhere in the middle.
I do think that they are very closely paying attention to people's responses, because I don't think we would have gotten official Geode fan art if people weren't all like, fucking Geode!
Just the way the cult of Geode took off.
I know. But we're talking about Marcion. We'll get to Geode. So,
Marcion.
And the Nihil.
Yes. So, this is once again that thing where we are one book into the sort of into the adult run, the Del Rey run, because Marcion is like in Into the Dark for half a page, but otherwise he's not in it, and he's not in A Test of Courage at all. So just in the one book he's like really, really in, and I'm not talking comics, he is of all the characters the most motivated, I find. We don't quite know what the motivation is in great detail. We have a vague idea of what he wants, like some wrong has been done to him by the Jedi.
I was telling my friend, who is always like 4 years behind in Star Wars books, except for Thrawn. She loves Thrawn, but that's because she's a hardcore Sherlockian, and that's how I wrangled her into Thrawn. I was like, he's the Sherlock Holmes of Thrawn. And she's like, give me all the books.
That's true, but he is.
He really is. I
thought of it like that.
And he has his Watsons.
He does.
Yeah. Eli, Karen, and Vader, it actually fits the Watson archetype. Anyway, that's a podcast I've done another time. Hey, guys, if you want to hear more about that on Jacobs and Jedi, I did an entire panel at 221 Beacon about Thrawn is the Sherlock Holmes of Star Wars, and you can find that somewhere in our feed. I don't have the episode in front of me. I have no idea what episode number it is. It's probably in the hundreds somewhere. But I was telling her about Marcion, and I told her he was like the methods of Thrawn with the brutality of Tarkin. Yeah. And because he's smart. He's clearly smart, and he's crafty. And I love that moment in Light of the Jedi. And it was because I did so much of Light of the Jedi on audiobook that I don't think this moment would have hit me as hard if I had been reading it. But I was driving, and you get that moment where, like, Loden and all of them are going after the family, and they're riding their horses, and they get that call. And I remember driving and hearing the voice come out of that call, and I was like, that sounds like Marcion Roe.
Like, yeah, you don't get that in the book, because it's not until the end when Loden's like, I know your voice, and he's like, I'm the one who called you. That's the only time you ever hear it.
Yeah, and I just have to also throw out that Mark Thompson did a stellar job on A Light of Courage, his audiobook. It is his best work by far. But I find him so crafty, and he's so smart, and he's thinking on that, like, Thrawn level of, like, three-dimensional chess. Like 4D chess. And I like when they tease us with a villain where he's really good, he's really confident, and we're three books in, we still don't know what the fuck he's doing. And I like that. Though I would like to start seeing, as we start moving into the next phase, start getting a few more concrete answers, because I think there is the problem, like the TV show Lost, if you give us too many questions and not enough answers, you start losing people.
Yeah.
And after three books and a smattering of comics, I want to start seeing more of Marcion's plans sooner rather than later.
I agree. I think I'm hoping that when Rising Storm comes out, because that seems to be like the Del Rey, I'm going to call them runs like they're comics, but they're not. Like the Del Rey run of books, I think, is where Marcion comes in most prominently. And I'm hoping that that's the next, like, we'll start getting some more answers in Rising Storm. Because, the two of us read everything and take it as one thing. But I think their plan was that if you're only reading the Del Rey or you're only reading the YA or the middle grade or whatever, that those should stand on their own as one age group, I guess. Which is where it all starts. That's where it kind of starts to fall apart, is with the next set. Because they're like, this set is fine if you only want to read the one. But then with the next set, we've got characters from A Test of Courage making the jump to YA. And they're not staying in the middle grade category. And then it's all going to start getting a little more confusing. So maybe we'll start getting more of Marcion in the other books too. But I feel like he's just sticking to the adult line for now.
That's really interesting, because I hadn't been seeing them as separate. I really hadn't, because that's actually my biggest gripe of Light of the Jedi, and probably why it's not my favorite of the three books out so far. That's definitely Into the Dark. Because there were parts of Light of the Jedi, and I am a slut for Charles Soule. I love that man. That man gave me my grande boyfriend's backstory. Like, I love that man. And when they let Charles Soule do his thing, it's stellar. Mm-hmm. But there are parts of Light of the Jedi that feel very corporate to me, mostly in the final third of the novel. And what I mean by corporate is, like, Jorah, Molly, and Skeer come in, like, in the final third, just to have Jorah die. And then you have, like, the ceremony at the Twilight... at the Twilight Beacon. I was about to call it the Twilight Sparkle, and that's definitely My Little Pony. at the Starlight Beacon, there's actually a character named Starlight in My Little Pony, and it keeps throwing me off. It's just full disclosure.
Really My Little Pony, somehow. It's all coming together.
I sat through all 9 seasons of that show and I love it. So there's a reason I have an animation podcast, so I can't talk about my love of My Little Pony. Anyway, that's not this podcast. There's just certain, like, moments, like when the dedication of the Starlight Beacon and Light of the Jedi, it's like, and there's Venestra and there's Wraith, and don't worry, they're in the next books. But it just felt like they were just thrown in there to be thrown in there. And I feel that way with Skeer and Jorah. It's like, we have to have these two characters, because Skeer is one of the main characters of the comics, and Jorah is, of course, Ruth's master in Into the Dark. So that's probably my biggest gripe of these books, is there are parts that do feel very corporate, which is why I wasn't seeing them as separate pieces on different lines. I was very much seeing them as one bundle, and not separate. So I find that that's really interesting to think of it that way, that I didn't even consider that jump from them going from middle grade to YA. I didn't even think about that. That's a good point.
I don't perceive them as different either, because, like, with me, I take all the books exactly as they are. Like, on my shelf, they're organized. YA and adult is chronological. It doesn't matter what the age group is. And then, like, the middle grade I put somewhere else because it didn't fit on the shelf. But so to me, I always take it as one big story. But the big thing going into the High Republic, because there are no familiar characters for a wider audience to latch onto, they're like, just pick wherever you want to start. And here are all the character flashcards, and here's who's in what book, and whatever appeals to you, take that book. But they do have to have that continuity of going from one to the other to the other for people like us who are going to jump back and forth, so we can see where that connective tissue is.
Mm-hmm.
But it does make me wonder, like, I feel like the adults from the adult book are staying in the adult book. Like Eivor, Elzar, Stellan Geos when we get him, who I'm obsessed with because he's like Regency era Obi-Wan Kenobi with Kylo Ren's lightsaber, so it's just doing things to me. But like, it's like, hey, we heard you like these two Jedi. What if we made them one character and put them in a period costume? I'm like, okay, well, so like all of them are gonna stay, I think, in the adult run, in the Del Rey run, and then the kid stuff's gonna jump back and forth.
I'm still laughing about Obi-Wan and Kylo's love child.
Well, that's what he is. He's got
he is. I see it now.
And he's all noble and shit. And then he's got, like, Kylo Ren's lightsaber, but it's blue.
He's all noble and shit.
It's worth noting that as of this recording, we haven't really seen Stellan Geos in anything. I've just decided he's all noble and shit.
I know. That's why it's so funny. Because, like, I think they're like, Yvonne and Elsa are like, that's my friend. And Vanessa's like, that was my master. And that was it.
That's the thing. Think about it this way. Is like, Anakin and Padme are like, Obi-Wan's our friend. And then Anakin on his own is like, Obi-Wan's my master. And he's actually the best. He is just the greatest. He's the sweetest boy. So I have no reason not to love Stellan Geos based solely on this.
He's just like, all my friends are like, are boning and I'm here. Where's my fleshlight?
I was gonna say I volunteer, but fine, fleshlight, that's fine.
They're Jedi, they're not allowed to have sex, are you? Except for the kid, but
they're not allowed to have attachments. I'm allowed to have attachments.
Well, you know, maybe it's a really good fleshlight. He's attached to it.
He's real attached to that fleshlight.
It's attachment to his lightsaber.
Oh boy.
Just to add a danger side of things.
This is how he falls to the dark side.
Yes. Anyway, good segue. So the Nihil.
Back to the Nihil. We got
back to the Nihil.
The one time I have full license to talk about Marcian Rowe and I start talking about Stellan Geass. So.
No, I like the Nihil as villains. Because we've seen pirates, we've seen raiders, but they're almost to me like this in between of crime syndicate and pirates. Mm-hmm. I think they want to be pirates, but what's his butt? Marcian.
They're pirates that function like a syndicate.
Yeah,
the hierarchy of a syndicate.
And I think he wants that. And I think that's where I kind of get like very Maul vibes at times from Marcian too. He has that like Crimson Dawn Maul vibes. He just needs his Kira to be his beautiful lap partner. Yeah, or maybe just some lovely lady named Sulla.
Yeah. Well, it's true. I love it.
Arzu has a fic for that.
I got a fic for that. DM me if you want details.
But, gosh, you should really promote it more. It's really good.
Honestly, I would promote my fic more, like, on Twitter, if employers weren't checking it.
Oh, that's a good point.
I'm not ashamed to talk about it. I am very open on Twitter with the fact that I do write fan fiction. And if you are properly motivated on Twitter, you can find me on AO3 via my Twitter feed. If you're properly motivated, I just don't openly post it because people who are hiring me for other jobs check my Twitter feed.
Oh, fuck. I'm never getting hired for anything ever again.
But they're hiring me for writing jobs specifically. If it was like an engineering job, I'd be like, whatever. I'm an engineer and here's all the smut I write. But yeah, it's purely because they're hiring me to write stuff like this that I'm like, I don't need to make it easy for you. But if you're properly motivated, you can actually find it.
You should just also put in like romance novel writer, like in your like little thing, so people know that you write smut, but you do it professionally.
Yeah.
You could easily scrub your fan fiction with Marcian and Sulla and publish it as a romance. Like you could, that's an easily scrubbable fic.
Once it's finished and I've gotten it all worked out, it's been on AO3 for a little bit, I intend on scrubbing it. Because I'm like, the thing is, tying back into sort of what we were saying, is we don't know a whole hell of a lot about Marcian Rowe at this point. So, like, 85% of what I write about Marcian Rowe is purely something I'm making up. Like, Nihil dynamics, what goes on in his head, like, what kind of person he is, because we don't know much of this. So I guess, yeah, I need to finish this before Rising Storm comes out, because then it's all going to go to hell.
That's where I feel on my Thrawn fic. No, but like, I think that's, yeah. I like the Nihil because on one hand, it's very obvious what they are. They're very clearly raiders who are like there to, you know, fuck people up and pillage and raid and rape and take what they want, right? But then you do have Marcian, and he is so enigmatic, and he's mysterious, and we know, like, nothing about him. And I think that's definitely what makes him dangerous, especially with how he treats Mari. And Mari's Santeca? Solteca? Santeca. Santeca.
You're getting her confused with Sola Santeca?
I am. Your fault.
It's not my fault. I'm sorry.
How he treats Mari, which was such a big reveal to know that, you know, the Santecas that we see from, you know, The Force Awakens has this line to them and that they have this entire corporate feel themselves. And all that is just really fascinating, but I definitely hope that gets pulled back in more because I was very excited to see the Santecas and I'm just like, the gays! And I'm like, oh, they're tiny gay Jeff Bezoses and they're evil. But maybe good? I don't know. They're in it for themselves because they're corporate people and I don't trust corporations. But watching how Mari and Marcian interact, it creates amazing power dynamics that I'm He clearly knows how to use and control people, which makes me wonder what's going to happen with Loden, because I really, Loden was my boy. Like he still is my boy. Like, I fell in love with Loden Greatstorm, and I am so happy that one of my favorite artists on Twitter has been doing Loden artwork. I'm just like, yes. but I that's really interesting, because where I feel like Dez fell easily to the Dringir, who we'll talk about in a second, in Into the Dark, a lot, he fell so easily because he was also injured. You know, he smacked his head and had a concussion. But I don't feel like Loden is going to be in the same position as Dez. And I don't think he's going to fall so easily. So I'm actually really interested in the dynamics between Loden and Marcion. And that, like, mental and emotional battle. And I really hope we get that, because it's going to be just a battle of will and abilities and mental abilities. And yes.
There's two things about this whole thing with Loden that fascinate me. Three things. One of them is just Marcion's attention to his name. Because I know Great Storm, like the Nile, everything they do is storm related.
I got to that moment, I just died laughing. I was like, Charles Soule, you petty bitch.
But I'm like, was that intentional? Is he just making a comment like, hey, that's kind of a funny coincidence? Or like, does it mean something? Because my brain starts immediately churning. I'm like, did the Great Storms kill your family? Like, this is where I went. And then there's that. There's the fact that by fixing on that name, remembering that Marcion Rowe is not Marcion's real name. And what is his real name? And does it matter? And I know I'm all like, what is your family that you felt the need to change your name? Is it just to keep yourself sort of safe? Or is it something that the Republic would recognize? And maybe that's why you changed it. And then the third thing is the cylinder that he has. And like what it is. Now I have my own theories that are in my fic, or
it's
will
a fleshlight.
It's a fleshlight. No, that's not what.
Fine, I'm sorry. No, we'll get off the fleshlight. We all know it's a dildo. It's fine.
Well, come on, Hope. At the very least.
I mean, anything can be a dildo if you're, you know,
if really you try gung-ho. Hard enough.
Yes, if you're gung-ho enough about it.
If you're that determined, the evil screaming cylinder can in fact be a dildo. Faces on it,
then it would be screaming. It'd just be like, no.
Or is it screaming because it's having a good time?
I forgot that it screams. That makes it so much worse.
No, it's not. Does it actually scream, or does it just look like it's screaming?
I don't know. Here, where's my book?
Because I know Elzar has visions of this, and he starts screaming because he's envisioning this cylinder, like right at the end. But I don't know if it just looks like it's screaming or if it's actually screaming.
I don't know. Keep talking. I'll figure it out.
But, yeah, so these are the three things that interest me about that bit at the end. Specifically about how this cylinder, like, I'm almost positive it's a Jedi thing, just because Marcion has it. Marcion doesn't like the Jedi. And then Elzar has a vision of, either he has a vision of the cylinder or he has a vision, like, tinged in purple, and then the cylinder is purple. So, like, it's got to be related.
Here it is. Marcion reached in his tunic and pulled out an object of stone and metal, rod, 3 hands long, carved and incised with symbols, screaming faces, fires, chains. It looked like it had been melted once and reforged. As his hand touched the object, it began to glow a sickly purple color that somehow overpowered the star bright lighting of the prison deck.